Bonsoir, il me revient donc d'ouvrir les festivités de ce soir. Je dois dire que je suis vraiment extrêmement, extrêmement heureux de la présence d'Axel Honneth ce soir parmi nous. Quand je dis « je », c'est bien sûr un « nous » qu'il faut entendre, puisqu'il s'agit ici, pour ce soir, d'une rencontre co-organisée dans le cadre d'un cycle de conférences autour de la question « Pourquoi des penseurs en temps de crise ?» co-organisé par l'Université Bordeaux-Montaigne, par le TNBA, le Théâtre National de Bordeaux-Aquitaine, et par la librairie Mola. Cette rencontre, donc, est pour nous, sans aucun doute, un événement comparable, même s'il ne faut jamais juger à l'avance, mais un événement comparable à la venue, il y a quelques années de cela, de Judith Butler dans notre université. Un événement comparable également à la venue de Carlo Ginzburg ici même en début d'année et l'an dernier dans notre université, puisqu'il s'agit avec la venue d'Axel Honneth d'inaugurer un ensemble d'interventions très denses sur 3 jours. Donc ce soir, cette conférence vous sera délivrée par Axel Honneth en langue anglaise, mais avec une traduction face à vous, donc pour vous repérer, autour donc de la question de l'éducation et de la sphère publique démocratique. Nous continuerons demain et après-demain à l'Université Bordeaux-Montaigne par la tenue d'un colloque en sa présence avec tout un ensemble d'intervenants autour de la question des rapports entre capitalisme et démocratie, autour de l'œuvre d'Axel Honneth. Et à ce colloque fera suite la remise du titre de docteur honoris causa de l'Université Bordeaux-Michel de Montaigne, donc jeudi à 18h à l'amphi 700. Vous êtes bien sûr chaleureusement invités également à cette cérémonie dans laquelle vous pourrez à nouveau entendre Axel Honneth, cette fois-ci en allemand, parler avec une traduction assuré très gentiment par le Goethe-Institut, dont je remercie très chaleureusement la présence avec nous tout au long de ces 3 journées. Je voudrais dire très rapidement 2 mots sur le parcours d'Axel Honneth et aussi sur les éléments qui font que nous sommes ensemble ce soir. Son parcours, je le résumerai très rapidement. Axel Honneth est donc philosophe, professeur de philosophie à l'université Goethe de Francfort. Il est directeur de l'Institut de recherche sociale depuis 2001, institut de recherche sociale qui a vu notamment se succéder Horkheimer et Habermas. Et depuis 2011, il enseigne également à l'université Columbia à New York, où il donne un semestre de cours. Les raisons de sa présence aujourd'hui me semblent absolument évidentes, mais je voudrais les formuler d'une manière la plus simple possible. Au fond, quand on invite un philosophe, peut-être y a-t-il beaucoup de raisons pour l'inviter, mais en particulier, peut-être y a-t-il 2 raisons qui sont liés. On s'attend d'une certaine façon, quand un philosophe, un penseur, un intellectuel intervient, à ce que peut-être il puisse dire quelque chose de notre situation, de notre état du monde, notre état de vie aujourd'hui particulièrement. Et la manière de le dire est finalement assez importante. Parce que soit il s'agit d'inventer une langue philosophique, des concepts insolites en ce sens, qui n'ont jamais été forgés avant. Et chaque philosophe, beaucoup de philosophes, se reconnaissent par l'invention, la création de concepts singuliers. Soit il s'agit de reprendre un mot usité, un mot utilisé, un mot peut-être galvaudé, et d'en refaire sens, et de tramer avec ce mot et les expériences des gens tout un ensemble de relations qui deviennent à ce moment-là incontournables et fondamentales. Et il me semble qu'Axel Honneth, à partir de ce simple mot de reconnaissance, qu'entendons-nous par reconnaître quelqu'un ? Que signifie être reconnu ? A réussi à redonner vigueur à un terme utilisé par tous, mais en lui conférant une signification sans équivalent, au point que maintenant, nos expériences les plus ordinaires sont tramées, tissées par le concept de reconnaissance. Et sans doute, il y a là le propre d'un travail philosophique véritable, parce que pour arriver à cette expérience de pensée, il faut parcourir toute une histoire de la pensée, ce qu'a fait Axel Honneth en revisitant l'histoire de l'école de Francfort, à laquelle il est bien sûr associé étroitement, en revisitant donc le programme de la théorie critique de l'école de Francfort depuis Horkheimer, depuis le début dans les années 30, jusqu'à aujourd'hui, en revisitant aussi l'histoire de la pensée sociale, l'histoire de la philosophie, dont il a fait une interprétation magistrale de plusieurs auteurs, notamment de Hegel, mais aussi en langue française de Rousseau. Et d'ailleurs, ces deux penseurs ont chacun leur rôle dans une archéologie de la pensée sociale pour Axel Honneth, de telle sorte que, grâce à ce travail théorique sans équivalent, il a su redonner, je pense, vigueur et cohérence à un concept de reconnaissance qui ouvre toute une série d'interventions théoriques fondamentales. Ce concept de reconnaissance, il s'inscrit dans le projet d'une philosophie sociale qu'il s'agit justement de formuler, philosophie sociale dont je dirais que le rôle pour Axel Honneth est de proposer tout d'abord un diagnostic des pathologies sociales, diagnostic qu'il mène dans l'ensemble de ses interventions, de ces textes pathologiques, il faut entendre au sens de mutilation, d'amputation de la vie ordinaire de chacune et de chacun. Maintenant, le rôle de la philosophie sociale n'est pas seulement descriptif, il n'est pas de délivrer seulement un diagnostic des pathologies sociales comme un diagnostic du présent dans lequel nous vivons, il est aussi de proposer, au fond, un idéal émancipateur pour des collectifs, pour des sujets, et ainsi de mieux ancrer le rapport entre théorie et pratique. Là encore, on pourrait s'attendre à ce que, au fond, l'intellectuel, le théoricien, vienne dire de l'extérieur ce qu'il en est des mouvements sociaux, en apportant la clé de voûte théorique qui manquerait aux pratiques sociales d'émancipation, aux luttes pour l'émancipation. Or, rien de tel avec Axel Honneth, puisqu'il s'agit bien plutôt de considérer, de faire que le concept de reconnaissance qu'il formule, dont il sera encore question ce soir, le concept de reconnaissance puisse servir au fond d'outils théoriques à toute une série d'interventions pratiques qui elles-mêmes ont leur propre conceptualisation théorique, mais qui peuvent trouver sous la bannière de la reconnaissance, de la lutte pour la reconnaissance, des revendications en termes de reconnaissance, des occasions d'affirmer de nouvelles forces sociales, de nouvelles forces politiques. Bref, un programme à la fois critique, au sens fort du terme, et politique. Et c'est précisément pour appuyer ce programme que Axel Honneth affirme le rôle de la philosophie sociale à la jonction justement de la critique et de l'intervention. Et ici, je dirais que le collectif en général, les mouvements sociaux, les aspirations des sujets trouvent dans la possibilité d'une demande de reconnaissance de nouvelles occasions pour des luttes émancipatrices, sachant que la reconnaissance fait intervenir toute une série de sphères, de l'amour à la solidarité en passant par le droit, toute une série de pratiques, d'identités, qui sont autant de jalons dans la pensée d'Axel Honneth. Alors forcément, puisque nous sommes autour de la question « Pourquoi des penseurs en temps de crise ?», on peut naturellement, et ce sera ma façon lui laisser la parole, de vous laisser la parole, on peut naturellement essayer d'explorer les relations entre capitalisme et démocratie, le titre du colloque, de demain et d'après-demain, comme vous le faites dans votre propre parcours, en vous employant à montrer comment le capitalisme, et en particulier le capitalisme le plus récent, le plus tardif, a réussi entre guillemets, à réutiliser certains attendus des demandes de reconnaissance des sujets au travail qui aspirent à se réaliser, à devenir entrepreneurs d'eux-mêmes, pour mieux les tenir dans un univers du néolibéralisme qui est à la fois un univers de prescription, de contrôle et de gouvernement des conduites. Et donc forcément, vous attaquez dans un nombre de vos textes les plus récents à la nécessité de distinguer entre une philosophie de la reconnaissance d'un côté et ce qui est l'usage idéologique de la reconnaissance dans le système néolibéral dominant, avec cette question qui est de savoir si finalement la demande de reconnaissance ou la catégorie de reconnaissance peut demeurer un opérateur critique pour tout un ensemble de luttes aujourd'hui, alors même qu'il est repris en main, en quelque sorte, par le système néolibéral qui tend à se l'assimiler et à le proposer comme catégorie interne au monde du travail et au marché. C'est cette question que vous creusez dans nombre de vos derniers textes et qui, bien sûr, pose la question aussi du rôle conféré, en creux en tout cas, à l'éducation, puisque toute la question est de savoir, de mon point de vue, si une éducation à une philosophie de la reconnaissance peut prendre sens, éducation qui serait un prérequis finalement d'une éducation à la citoyenneté. Cette réflexion sur les rapports entre citoyenneté, éducation et reconnaissance, c'est précisément ce que vous vous proposez de reprendre ce soir pour nous, et donc nous en sommes très heureux, et je tiens encore à vous dire combien je suis heureux à titre personnel de votre présence parmi nous ce soir. Merci.
Yep. Before I start to read and to deliver my lecture, I would like to thank Guillaume Leblanc for this wonderful introduction. I mean, without any notes, as I could see. And I felt completely understood. So you have already, let's say, the horizon in which this lecture tonight will be situated. So the title is Education and the Democratic Public Sphere, a Neglected Chapter of Political Philosophy. Ever since its beginnings in the 19th century, the history of the public education system in democratic constitutional states has been a history of conflicts over the structure, form, and content of the instruction provided in schools. Neither the stratification of the school system nor the teaching methods or the curricula remained unaffected by the acrimonious disputes between state agencies on the one side and representatives of social groups and parents' associations on the other. The state's recognition of a right on the part of each citizen to receive an education had an explosive potential, which Kant may have anticipated in the following sentence from his lectures on pedagogy. And I quote Kant, "Two human inventions can probably be regarded as the most difficult, namely the arts of government and education. And yet there is still controversy about their very idea," end of quote. For Kant, the parallel between the art of government and the art of education was suggested by the fact that both are socially created practices fulfilling the same function, albeit in the distinct dimensions of species history and individual history, phylogeny and ontogeny. Through the prudent choice of means and methods, which is to say, in an artful way, both are meant to instruct us on how to effect a transition from a state of minority to a state of freedom. Be it with regard to a whole people consisting of individual subjects, or be it with regard to a child still subjected to the rule of nature within him or herself. What initially looks like a mere analogy is developed far beyond that in the course of Kant's lectures, where he points out that education and a republican political order mutually presuppose each other. The young human being governed by nature has to undergo an educational process aimed at freedom before he can become a member of a self-governing political community. Conversely, only autonomous citizens are able to institutionalize a system of public education that enables their children to attain political maturity. Good upbringing and a republican political order require each other because the former, in the form of public education, first produces the cultural and moral capacities that make it possible for the latter to exist and thrive in such a way that the active citizens even take an interest in the political emancipation of the lower classes of society. As in Rousseau's Emile, Kant's pedagogy draws on the idea of the good citizen as a link between pedagogic theory and the theory of government, between a conception of education and political philosophy. Neither could exist without the other, since both spell out inseparable preconditions of a democratic political community. It is this very close internal interrelation that explains why within the political and philosophical discourse of modernity, virtually no notable theorist of democracy has failed to offer a systematic contribution to educational theory. Beginning with Rousseau and Kant, through Schleiermacher, and up to Emil Durkheim and John Dewey, numerous important thinkers found it natural to devote entire books to the subject of public education. They thought of pedagogy conceived as the theory of the standards and methods of the adequate teaching of children as the twin sister of democratic theory. Without proper reflection on how to render a child both capable of cooperation and morally independent, it seemed to them impossible to explain what it could mean to speak of the project of democratic self-determination. The idea of the good citizen was not an empty phrase or an ornament for political speeches, but a practical challenge calling for the theoretical elaboration and even the experimental testing of suitable school types and teaching methods. Thus, when it came to the challenge of rehabituating an entire population, the German one, to the practices of democratic politics that had been systematically eradicated under National Socialism, the American occupying forces found it natural to draw on the pedagogical writings of John Dewey. The ties between democratic theory and pedagogical practice were still so close, and the internal relation between them still appeared so obvious, that the project of teaching democratic habits to the demoralized citizens of a thoroughly destroyed, unjust state was not perceived as objectionably paternalistic. Since then, however, the conceptual link between democracy and education and between political philosophy and pedagogy has been severed. To be sure, efforts are still made to reinvigorate theoretical reflection on democratic education, but nowadays these efforts tend to come from a pedagogical discourse abandoned by philosophers. They are no longer at the center of political philosophy itself. Democratic theory, in all its manifold guises and voices, tends to be silent on the pedagogical aspect of its subject matter. It has nothing to offer with regard to either the methods or the contents of primary and secondary education. Political philosophy today seems to have lost the insight that a thriving democracy must continually reproduce the cultural and moral preconditions of its own existence by way of general educational processes. These remarks on the intimate relation between education on the one hand and political freedom and democracy on the other are merely preliminary, and I will elaborate them in more detail in the second part of my talk. Before I do that, I will, in the first part of my talk, venture an explanation for the decoupling of pedagogy from political philosophy. It will turn out that the reasons for this development are found in the confluence of two courses that have, as it were, an elective affinity with each other. First, a certain problematic conception of the cultural presuppositions of democracy. Second, a misunderstanding of the idea of the neutrality of the state. Once I have my case for a rapprochement between the two areas in both negative and positive terms, I will proceed in a third step to outline the challenges faced by a reinvigorated program of democratic education. Since an extended treatment of this last point would require much more time than I have available for this talk, I will limit myself to some brief remarks with regard to it. So I come to my first chapter of these three chapters. Whereas Kant, Durkheim, and Dewey considered the topic of democratic education an intrinsic part of their respective projects in political philosophy, its role in contemporary normative democratic theory has become a marginal one. It is still occasionally mentioned, and introductory texts sometimes identify it as a part of the general subject matter of political philosophy, but its proper delimitation and development is left to educational theory. Democratic theory has uncoupled itself from its twin sister, the study of the adequate organization and methods of democratic education, and it has thereby deprived itself of the chance to make a proper contribution regarding the normative functions of preschool, primary, and secondary education, and adult education. Some might rest content with observing that this development simply reflects a more general differentiation of scientific disciplines over the course of the past 200 years. Just as philosophy in the second half of the 19th century parted ways with social theory, which then established itself as the discipline of sociology, so too the increasing specialization of philosophy required it to withdraw from the project of determining the educational processes required for the development of mature democratic politics. But it is quite apparent that things are not so simple when one considers that political philosophy constantly encounters the problem of education without having so much as the beginnings of a solution to it. With the political establishment of compulsory education, state-administered schooling has become a crucial instrument for forming the habits and abilities of each new generation, influencing future citizens for better or for worse. The type, methods, and contents of school education may affect a democracy either in positive ways, for example, by fostering cooperativeness and individual self-esteem, or in negative ones, gradually undermining democracy by teaching moral conformism and unquestioning obedience to authority. Thus, the question regarding the proper kind of state-mandated education has been at the heart of political philosophy from its very inception. Just think of Plato's Republic. Any serious reflection on the question how a state or political community should be constituted given the fundamental features of human nature has had to confront the closely related question what and whom to teach and by what methods to do so. The fact that this question has nowadays largely vanished from political philosophy and is no longer being pursued by it in either positive or negative terms cannot be due simply to the thought that the topic can be more productively and more adequately pursued by a specialized discipline. The problem of state-organized education is far too central to political agency and far too consequential with regard to the possibility of democracy and the rule of law for it to be straightforwardly separable from the theory or philosophy of politics. If we wish to explain the current separation between democratic theory and educational theory, we must therefore look to causes other than the progressive differentiation of academic disciplines. I suspect that the explanation will be located at a more fundamental conceptual level, having to do with the proper demarcation of the extent to which democracy is able to affect itself. As a rule of thumb, we can say that this extent will be more limited the less a democratic state is able to influence the conditions of its own existence, be it due to normative constraints or because of its operative limitations. When this space for self-generating activity on the part of the democratic state is thought of as being quite confined, the political significance accorded to school education will be correspondingly reduced, since it is then no longer regarded as a powerful instrument of change. It seems to be, to me, that theoretical shifts of this sort, that is to say, a certain disillusionment about the self-generative powers of democratic communities, are primarily responsible for the fact that school education and its administration by the state receive only scant attention from political philosophers today. Let me mention two of the theoretical sources that may account for the fact that over the past few decades, democratic theory has unwittingly and through almost imperceptible changes lost its faith in the value that state-run education has for democracy. To be sure, one could cite other causes besides these, such as the observation that children's character are formed through socialization in early childhood and thus during a developmental phase over which the state has little control. But I will restrict myself to the following two aspects since they fall squarely within the domain of political philosophy, properly speaking. First, the idea that the liberal democratic state has only a very limited ability to regenerate the moral and cultural resources on which it relies may owe its currency in part to the view defended by the German constitutional lawyer Ernst Wolfgang Böckenförde, and therefore often referred to in Germany as the Böckenförde theorem, that a democratic state depends for its reproduction on a supply of cultural traditions that themselves precede democracy. Although Böckenförde seems originally to have intended this view in a rather narrow sense as pertaining to the ethical preconditions for the functioning of modern legal systems, his thesis is nowadays given a much broader interpretation and is taken to refer to the cultural dependency of democratic constitutional states quite generally. On this more general reading, democratic political systems require the cultural support of ethical customs and habits whose cultivation and flourishing these systems themselves lack the means to promote. At the most general level, the so-called Böckenförde theorem is even taken to assert that democracies owe their social survival to the existence of moral attitudes that can thrive only in tradition-oriented communities governed by substantial ethical or even religious conceptions. Once this last view is adopted, it is only a short step to the conclusion that state-run educational processes, that is to say school and preschool education, lack any value for the formation of democratic habits and attitudes. For whatever moral attitudes facilitate cooperative political decision-making, tolerance, empathy, or concern for the common good, they are acquired not as a response to school teaching, no matter how well thought of, but solely through processes of ethical socialization within pre-political communities. Whereas in Böckenförde, there are at least some hints that education and schooling are capable of fulfilling the relevant functions. The common reception of his view reduces it to the claim that democratic societies are forced to rely on the survival of tradition-based ethical communities. All efforts on the part of the state to ensure a general democratic education are thought to be in vain, since they are held to be unable to generate the ethical virtues whose existence is vital to the continued functioning of any democracy. The increasingly widespread adoption of this view within political philosophy is likely to be one of the factors that have led recent democratic theory to avoid questions regarding public education. Such questions are bound to appear irrelevant to the extent to which it is assumed that democratic dispositions are acquired not through state-mediated educational processes, but rather in the pre-political environments furnished by tradition-oriented communities. Yet the popular version of the Böckenförde theorem is not the only thing that accounts for the increasing distance taken by contemporary democratic theory from its twin sister, educational theory. The tendency just described is met from another, more normative direction by the tendency to construe the idea of state neutrality in such a demanding way that even the principles of democratically organized collective decision-making are no longer permitted to shape public school education. Just like the culturally conservative reinterpretation of democracy, according to which the latter can survive only thanks to a supply of cultural traditions that precede it, so too the radicalization of the ideal of state neutrality has taken place, as it were, behind the backs of political philosophers, rather than having been consciously intended by them. It may even be that this second theoretical shift has been an unintended consequence of a well-intentioned effort to accommodate the increasing plurality of ethnic and religious cultures within contemporary society by emphasizing the strict impartiality of state-administered education. Of course, the degree of state neutrality has always been subject to changes in political attitude that reflect, albeit in complex ways, the ethical convictions of a majority and thereby a variable balance of social power. Ultimately, the only constraint that the ideal of neutrality imposes on the legitimacy of a political commitment to substantive values is simply that the universalist principles of democratic constitutions must not thereby be violated. In the long-standing debate over the inevitable partiality of the state's activity, the tradition from Kant to Durkheim and Dewey that I identified earlier took it for granted that state-administered education should embody exactly those values that have led to the decision to make such education compulsory for all future citizens in the first place. The right of the parents to impart to their children their own particular values had to end at the school door, so that the pupils could then practice the reflective habits that would enable them to take part in the process of joint public decision-making. But if it once appeared completely natural for school teaching to be geared towards the democratic procedures that were operative in making school attendance obligatory in the first place, doubts are increasingly voiced today. Some appeal to the constraint of state neutrality to caution against overburdening school education with political values alien to its purpose. Others, for example, concerned parents, complain that placing too much emphasis on the theme of democracy might get in the way of promoting career skills. When these kinds of well-worn reservations meet with unexpected public support, owing to the growth of multiculturalism, which does in fact speak in favor of removing certain ideological relics from our schools, we are faced with a vague mixture of truth and falsehoods that lead to the rejection of all forms of partiality in school education as equally harmful or objectionable. The political constraint of state neutrality is thereby extended to the point where even the very idea of a democratic education is no longer a matter of normative common sense. To be sure, these radicalized conceptions of state neutrality have not yet become pervasive in contemporary political philosophy. There is an ongoing debate about how to properly adapt this part of the legacy of liberal political thought to the increasing heterogeneity of cultural values in present-day societies. But when we take into account the culturally conservative reinterpretations of the survival conditions of democracy that I was describing earlier, we can discern a theoretical development that may well result in the view that the methods and contents of state-administered education must be purged of all democratic goals. This is the direction indicated, for example, by proposals that schools should be in charge only of an educational civic minimum, that parents should be given vouchers allowing them to choose educational options with this or that specific ideological tendency, or that teachers should no longer be considered as state agents, but rather as answerable solely to the parents. However tentative such considerations may initially be, the further they are taken, and the more public schools thus come to be thought of as subject to the constraint of ethical neutrality, in juxtaposition to a plurality of ethically committed private schools, the greater becomes the threat to one of the very few instruments that a democratic society has at its disposal to regenerate its own ethical foundations. In this way, conflicts over a state-run school system, regardless of whether they concern its structure, curriculum, or methods, are always at the same time conflicts over the sustainability of democracy. No philosophical tradition was more aware of this nexus than the one initiated by Kant and culminating in the work of Durkheim and John Dewey. So I come to my second chapter. The considerations I have advanced so far have been of a negative sort. The criticism of some tendencies in contemporary democratic theory has already revealed the premises on which we will have to rely if we are looking to understand the public school system as a necessary complement of democratic decision-making, and in fact as an integral and prior part of it. We have seen that we must neither sacrifice the guiding hypothesis that it is possible for education to foster the capacity for public deliberation even outside the specific context of early childhood socialization and traditional ethical communities, nor must we jeopardize the authority of the constitutional state to infuse democratic goals into the educational structures it sets up. Viewed from a positive angle, we can say that foremost among the tasks of a democratic constitutional state is the task to provide educational opportunities that will equally enable each of its future citizens to participate in the public legitimation of his or her own choices without fear or shame. In Kant's treatise on education, which was strongly influenced by Rousseau's Emile, without following it in every respect, this general idea results only in the defense of public education, accessible to all, against the champions of domestic education. The advantage of the former, according to Kant, so public education, is that it can foster in each pupil the virtues and capacities of a future citizen while sidestepping the danger of perpetuating family defects. So that's Kant's formulation, family defects or family mistakes. Everything that such educational processes are meant to impart, first, mechanical skills, second, pragmatic prudence, third, moral autonomy, is subordinate, in Kant's view, to the goal of creating within the individual a corresponding number of layers of self-respect and self-esteem, which taken together allow him to act with self-confidence as a citizen of a republic. The question of how these three sets of pedagogically imparted abilities are supposed to contribute to the exercise of a profession in adult age does not arise here at all, since all these abilities are considered solely for the contribution they make to an individual's acquisition of various kinds of self-esteem. Kant anticipates a famous thought found in the work of John Rawls when he maintains that a future citizen must first and foremost have access to the key good of self-respect before he or she is able to participate in republican self-legislation as an equal among equals. Professional skills, civic competence, and moral principles are here conceived of not primarily as teachable means by which individuals are enabled to secure an income for themselves, but rather as generalized media of social recognition, which the young acquire through a pedagogical process and which gradually make them aware of possessing a certain worth or value in the eyes of others. By learning technical skills, the young person gains respect, and I quote, with regard to himself as an individual, as Kant puts it almost in the same words later used by Hegel. The acquisition of civic knowledge affords him public worth as a citizen, and the acquisition of moral principles earns him, and I quote, value in view of the entire human race. Despite all his remarkable insights regarding the interrelation between general public education and reciprocal recognition within a republican political community, Kant is still quite far away from drawing conclusions with regard to the proper methods and organization of school teaching. He is thinking of the individual male pupil who is to develop self-esteem through the pedagogically mediated acquisition of knowledge rather than of a cooperative community where each individual must be able to act as a recognized member in concert with all others for the purpose of joint decision-making. While at some points of his pedagogy, Kant senses that a republic has a much greater need for fostering the communicative virtues than it has for simply imparting knowledge, he still recoils from the consequence of identifying the public school first and foremost as a place where democratic capacities are formed. This step is taken about 100 years later by Emil Durkheim and John Dewey, both of whom seek in their works to elucidate the internal relation between education and democracy, between learning at school and becoming a democratic citizen. Even though the basic assumptions made by each of these two thinkers, Dewey and Durkheim, appear to be in deep conflict with those of the other, on one side, the sociologist with scientific inclinations, on the other, the vocal exponent of pragmatism in philosophy, their reflections on democratic education share a surprising range of features. Among the three functions that a contemporary perspective would attribute to education in primary and secondary schools, to provide essential qualifications for entering a profession, to compensate educational deficits stemming from family or social background, and to offer a general preparation for the role of citizen, Durkheim and Dewey focus exclusively on the last. For them, just as for Kant, The acquisition of professional knowledge is merely a side product of the training of democratic dispositions. And the task of educational compensation is thought to lie with the individual community that is each particular school. In justifying the state's authority to put the tax-funded educational system in charge of generating civic capacities, both thinkers advance similar arguments, to the extent that they think arguments are needed here at all. If it is granted that the introduction of compulsory schooling by the state can be conceived as a democratically legitimate act only when it is interpreted as joint civic effort to equally enable all citizens to exercise their political rights, then it is not cogent to abrogate the state's right to use school teaching to train the requisite abilities and practices. Yet such considerations at the level of democratic theory constitute only the general framework within which Durkheim and Dewey develop their more detailed studies regarding the content and structure of school education. Here again, we find significant parallels between their respective arguments. Their common point of departure is the thesis that to prepare for the role of citizen is less a matter of acquiring the right kind of knowledge than it is a matter of acquiring certain practical habits. What the pupil should learn in school is not primarily testable knowledge of political or historical or technical facts, but rather modes of conduct that enable self-confident action within a cooperative community. It may not come as a particular surprise that the pragmatist John Dewey was led in this direction and came to view schools above all as places where a public engages in communal inquiry. But how is it that a similar line is taken by Emil Durkheim, who likewise looks at schools for how they can train their capacity for democratic cooperation, is something that I will need to briefly elaborate on. In contrast with Dewey, who was much more optimistic in this regard, Durkheim is initially guided by the Kantian idea that a child's innately egoistic inclinations need to be curbed by moral discipline before it can learn to autonomously conform to the social rules of a democratic community. Yet Durkheim departs from his philosophical teacher Kant in picturing this preparatory educational process as proceeding more smoothly and with greater chances of success the more it engages the child's passions and desires, that is to say, her sensible nature, for example, by drawing on practical role models and playful activity. Thus, for Durkheim, the overcoming of infantile egoism is not, in fact, a process of moral discipline, even though he repeatedly describes it as such. It is rather a process of affective habituation. By participating in practices that are adequate to her in that they engage her inclinations, the child initially comes to master at a merely habitual level the rules of a democratic existence that it should later, with increasing age, come to comprehend in their rational validity. With regard to schools and their methods of education, the conclusions Durkheim reaches on the basis of these revisions of Kant's view are almost the same ones at which Dewey arrives from his quite different Hegelian premises. Through cooperative learning, through active participation in all the school's affairs and through communal rather than individualized kinds of criticism and encouragement, pupils should be habituated early on to acquire the spirit of democratic cooperation that will allow them in adult age to present themselves with self-confidence in the public political arena. Thus, neither of the two thinkers shares the view commonly taken today that the primary school of goal of school attendance is the development of individual autonomy. Instead, their models of education are shaped by the idea that the pupil should acquire a reliable sense of what it means to treat their fellow pupils as equal partners in a shared process of learning and inquiry. If a public school has the task of engendering in each successive generation the practical dispositions that are vital for the possibility of democratic decision making, then it must aim at habituating those it seeks to educate in a culture of association, rather than just at imparting to them a grasp of moral principles. The crucial contribution that school education can make to the regeneration of democracy lies not in teaching individual rules of right action, but in a communicative practice that fosters moral initiative and the ability to take up the perspective of others. We should, of course, note that not only did 100 years pass between Kant's lectures and pedagogy and the arguments just presented. Another 100 years have passed since then. In view of this long interval, some may shake their heads and triumphantly point out that along with the social and economic conditions, the requirements on schooling too have radically changed. The greatly increased number of pupils, the economic demand for flexibility and motivation, the educational deficits that despite many efforts persist in the lower segments of society, all this seems to leave highly developed capitalist countries with no other choice but to place increasing emphasis in school teaching on selectivity, individualized assessment, and the encouragement of competitive behavior. In the United States, politicians, economic experts, and managers are already calling for thoroughgoing reform of the entire education system, proposing measures whose cumulative effect it would be to make teaching entirely subservient to the goal of transmitting marketable skills. According to these proposals, the effectiveness of all American schools should be subject to ongoing quantitative comparison, where the success of individual teachers is measured by their students' placement in nationally standardized tests. Controls of this kind, which sooner or later would have the effect of marginalizing all subjects not amenable to statistical evaluation, are discussed not only in the United States, but also in Europe, as though here too one were hoping to subject schools to the dictate of economic developments by employing measurement methods familiar from the financial sector. Given these circumstances, there might seem to be little point in recalling times when public education was regarded as the linchpin of democratic self-renewal. Not only democratic theory, but politics itself seems to have lost interest in the only kind of institution that is suited to constantly regenerate, albeit tentatively and with great effort, the fragile preconditions of a people's democratic decision-making. If these tendencies seem to point to the abandonment of the idea of a democratic education, they are at the same time contradicted by a multitude of empirical findings that have resulted from comparative education studies and from the PISA surveys over the past several years. These data marvelously illustrate what Durkheim and Dewey anticipated in their reflections a century ago, when they insisted on a close correlation between cooperative democracy-oriented teaching methods on the one hand and pupils' performance at school on the other. The school system that consistently comes out on top in all international comparisons of scholastic achievement is the same one that comes closest to realizing the democratic ideals of the two thinkers. In Finnish schools, pupils from different educational backgrounds remain in the same school together as long as possible. Tests and examinations are reduced to a bare minimum. Communicative responsibility and mutual trust are given much greater weight than individual attributability. And choices regarding teaching methods are made by the professionally trained teachers themselves in cooperation with student representatives. It is true that descriptions of the Finnish school system do not employ the terminology used by Durkheim and Dewey. There is no talk of habituation, nor of communal morality or cooperative methods of education. But such retranslations into a language of democratic education could easily be supplied and would then reveal an instance of the rare and fortunate situation where what is politically and normatively right coincides with what is pragmatically useful. The types of school education that are best with a view to pupils' cognitive achievements and abilities turn out to be those that are also most suited to the regeneration of democratic dispositions. In times when talk of growing political apathy is ubiquitous, and when some even speak of the threat of post-democracy, there is no reason whatsoever not to revive the tradition inaugurated by Kant, Durkheim, and Dewey, and to conceive of public education as a crucial instrument for the self-reproduction of democracies. So I come to my last and short chapter. What I have been saying so far may have created the impression that, like the proper methods of democratic education, its contents too are fixed once and for all, removed from all historical change. Kant, in particular, played a part in suggesting such a view, since he tied the acquisition of the necessary forms of civic self-respect to the successive mastery of timelessly valid portions of knowledge. But Durkheim too exhibits a tendency to prescribe a certain fixed subject matter to all processes of cooperative education. Only John Dewey resisted this tendency and soberly pointed out throughout his pedagogical writings that along with the various challenges that require public democratic problem solving, the material to be taught in schools must also change. Like Durkheim, he believes that a hierarchical ordering of subjects is indispensable. Curiously, he accords the highest rank to geography. But what exactly it is that pupils should cooperatively learn in these disciplines is, in his view, determined by the historically changing tasks of democratic decision-making. Before I end my lecture, I would like, in a Dewean spirit, to at least briefly name those two historical challenges whose consequences for our democratic coexistence create a particular need for adjustments in school curricula. In both cases, more detailed considerations would likely show that the challenges cannot be properly treated within the confines of any one individual subject, and that they should rather be addressed more or less across the entire range of the curriculum. For any observant person, there can be no doubt that the digital revolution of our communicative relations will lead to profound changes not only in the ways in which private relationships are initiated and maintained, but also with respect to the processes by which political views are formed. The internet, which brings about both a despatialization and an acceleration of each individual's interactions with others, is creating an ever more quickly growing number of virtual public spheres whose outer boundaries are in permanent flux. It is certainly a task of primary and secondary education to prepare school children both technologically and socially for the use of this new medium. But this hardly exhausts the efforts that will be required to address its historical consequences. It seems to me that it will be also that it will also be necessary for children to jointly explore both the potentials and the limits and dangers of the new medium by experimentally investigating how digitally disseminated topics and bodies of information are generated. This might be done, for instance, by examining the genesis and quality of specific Wikipedia entries. Selective reconstructions of this sort would require the close cooperation of different subjects, since specific knowledge of the relevant fields would be needed over and above purely technical and economic expertise. This one particular example will have to suffice to illustrate the much broader idea that what is needed in our schools today is the ability not merely to use the internet, but also to understand its specific mode of production and the range of its effects. In the spirit of Dewey, the cooperative use of computers should prepare the pupils for the mature and responsible use of new instruments for political decision making. The digital revolution is the first of the two historical challenges facing the democratic public today. The second one is the increasing heterogeneity of the population of Western countries. As with respect to the novel medium, that is the internet, so too with regard to multiculturalism. Few will disagree that schools have to do everything within their powers to prepare their pupils for these changes in the conditions under which public opinion is formed. But here again, we need to ask which pedagogical methods and contents will be best suited to this task. The idea of a democratic education that my talk has tried to recall to us offers an answer to the first part of this question regarding methods. The less a pupil is treated as an isolated subject meant to deliver a certain performance, and the more he or she is approached as a member of a cooperative learning community, the more likely is the emergence of forms of communication that allow not only for a playful acceptance of cultural differences, but that positively conceive of such differences as opportunities for mutual enrichment. But to point in this way to the power of democratic education to facilitate recognitive relationships does not yet answer the second part of our question concerning the consequences that the growth of multiculturalism should have for the content of what is taught. Let me close by suggesting that at present we cannot even adequately imagine what the content should look like 15 or 20 years from now, if fair and equal considerations is to be given to the cultural and ethnic composition of school classes. In order for those future pupils to grow into mature participants in a highly heterogeneous and colorful mixed public sphere, they will have to learn to approach history, literature, geography, and most other subjects from the same sort of decentralized perspective that we today are still struggling to gradually teach ourselves in the context of a number of academic disciplines. Thank you very much.